This is Smarter San Diego TV.
You know, millennials and baby boomers alike, they want to be in urban environments right now.
Thank God for the Electoral College vote.
In a four-hour breakfast, we raised $9,000. So that's something that we take pretty seriously.
And you can't diet your way into being lean and fit. They go together.
In New York City, deciding what's best for the rest of the freaking country.
This is not a market built on a stack of cards. It's a solid foundation.
0%. That is a thumbs up.
Everyone has a life worth telling a story about. And the more adversity that you faced, the deeper your story.
Well, am I going to be okay? You know, like, am I going to be able to walk?
There's just so much creativity in this town that it's hard to hide it.
Well, you have these beliefs. Well, what do you do with it?
The Life of the Party is here to help you navigate the selling and buying process in San Diego real estate. Give it up for the broker associate of Welcome to San Diego Real Estate, Nicole Hazelton.
And she's back. The Life of the Party is here. Nicole Hazelton, how are you doing?
Thank you. I'm well. Thanks for having me.
Good to have you here. Obviously, you've participated on Win This Listing.
I did.
A couple of times.
Yes.
And so you know that I talk to home sellers on a regular basis, every single day, actually. This market right now, because values have gone up, really seems to be kind of like a move-up market.
Yes.
Right? You bought your house five, 6 years ago. It's gone up a lot in value. You look at it and you go, hey, we got the equity to put a down payment on a bigger house. Let's giddy up. But there are a lot of things that come with a sell-buy scenario. And almost every person I talk to when this listing, it's a sell-buy scenario. So I want to sell one house, buy another house, concurrently, one move. So we have you here today, obviously, to talk about what that looks like. Mm-hmm. And how do you navigate that in this particular marketplace? So what are the first things that people should think about in that situation?
Gosh, you know, it's funny because everyone thinks that the finesse of that type of deal where you're selling and buying concurrently comes at the very end when everyone's starting to move and trying to work out the move-in, move-out situation. It starts at the very beginning with the contracts. So there's so many balls in the air at any given time for that type of transaction. So if you're the client, you're selling your property, you're going to use your equity to purchase the other property. The first thing you need to think about is when you find a buyer for your property, you have to have a contingency in place to locate your replacement property. If you don't, you might be selling your property and you might be out of a place to live. So that's number one.
Okay, so you need a contingency so that you can find a place.
Correct.
On the other side, okay.
Now at the same time, you're out looking at properties with your agent, you're writing offers that are contingent on your sale of your property. So when you find that magical property and the seller on that property decides to work with you, chances are that seller's also moving up, so there could be more than
another
one transaction happening at
the
same time.
Is this the three-legged dog we've had, yes. Three-legged stool or whatever we've talked about in the past?
Yes.
So first things first, I mean, I think that's one of the questions that people ask me the most is, well, what do I do? We have to find our home first before we can sell ours. Is that right? I mean, is that the way you should go about it? Or is that just sort of setting yourself up for failure? You look for a year, you find the house you love, but then you don't have your house sold yet, so then you can't even get it.
You should definitely put your house on the market. And then have that contingency in place. Know that you're not going to jump into a contract until you have located that replacement property, but you'll have more purchasing power when the right property comes along if you have a buyer for your property. So let's say that magical property comes along, you want to make a move. Well, that seller doesn't feel comfortable with you, that you don't even have your property listed on the market. So you'll have more purchasing power to have your offer accepted on that replacement property if you have your property, number one, listed, and even better if you have that property in escrow.
The Seinfeld generation, we call that having hand.
Yeah.
You want to have hand.
You want to have hand.
And you don't have hand if you're empty on your side.
Right.
But if you're full on your side, meaning you have a buyer in contract, you're in escrow, then you have hand. It's like, yeah, we're moving soon.
Right.
So it actually is, for sellers, that's kind of a motivating deal, right? It's like, hey, that's a good thing because these people, when their house sells, they're going to have to come in here.
They're going to have
to.
That's
a pretty motivated buyer right there.
Yep. And then you want to set the expectations for that seller when you're the buyer. So when you're initially writing the contract, you want to ask them up front, hey, I might ask you for an interim occupancy agreement. You know, you might ask them if you can move in a little bit earlier than close of escrow. Chances are they're going to say no. But that makes sense too when you're selling your property. When your buyer comes in, you're going to have to ask that buyer if they're comfortable with you leasing the property back for a couple of days while you're closing on your new property. Because you're going to need the funds on your sale to close on the new property, which means you have to close on that property, but you're not going to have any place to move until you close on the replacement property. So you have to have a couple of days of wiggle room, and if you set the expectation right up front and you say while you're negotiating the contracts, this is what we're going to need to do on the sale of our property, we might need to stay in a couple of extra days while we wire the funds, while we close on our replacement property. And then you get into all the fun things like the termite inspection. So let's say if the buyer on your place asked you to provide termite clearance. Well, when are you going to provide that? You need to be moved out of the property or vacate the property while the property is being tented. So those are types of things that you can write in or out of the transaction, maybe agree to do it.
As you become a man here, live on camera.
Agree to do it after close.
I've been hiding this for years, but
there's something I need to tell
time.
You. There's something to be said about equal pay.
But no, the finesse of the deal really comes at the beginning when you're negotiating the contract. So if you're offering to your buyer that you're going to provide termite clearance in the close, maybe you keep that out of the initial purchase agreement and you have that as a separate addendum so you can do that termite work after you've left the property.
Okay.
I've had a lot of transactions where the seller has three dogs and they have a fridge full of food and they're not moving into their replacement property for a week until they close escrow, but we need to have termite clearance to close their sale so that they can get their funds to close their purchase.
Mm.
So it's just a lot of moving parts.
A lot of chicken and the egg stuff going on.
Chicken and the egg.
You know, people, I think, are a little misguided in their own thoughts about this because everyone seems to say the same thing. Well, we got to find the next house before we can sell this one. And this house is going to sell right away, right? And everyone believes that. And in this hot market, in some cases, they're right. But right away isn't necessarily tomorrow afternoon.
Correct.
You know, there's a lot of things you have to do to sell a home. So I think what you're saying is position yourself, once you're serious, position yourself by listing your property and then be ready to negotiate terms based on whether you've found your next property or not.
Right.
In other words, someone comes in, they say, write a contract, say, hey, we want to move in, you know, 10-day close, and then we want to move in. You say, no, can't do it. We need to close on this and then stay here for a month or two while we find another house.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to negotiate that, you can. But
right.
You still have to have that buyer in place, and that's the thing that could take time.
Right, and you have contingencies in place. So the best case scenario is if you have a property that you think is sellable and you're going to have multiple offers in this market, then fantastic. You will find a buyer that will wait for you to find your replacement property. And if that buyer ends up backing out, you'll have backup buyers in turn to pick up the pieces and come in where they left off. So then you work your contingencies that concurrently with your sale and your purchase. You find that property, you get into escrow, you're doing your home inspection, your appraisal, getting your loan docs in order, while your buyer is doing the same thing on your property. So they don't technically have to start their time frames until you've found that replacement property, and then you're moving through the motions concurrently at the same time, and you're planning those contingency time frames around when your buyer is releasing contingencies. You make your deposit on that replacement property the same as what your buyer's deposit has on the line, so that you're completely covered 100%. Something goes wrong on your replacement, you're not forced to sell your home. And I have seen that happen, not with my clients.
It happens.
It happens.
It sure does. I sure hope it doesn't happen to you out there, but
yeah.
There are ways to avoid it. Use a good agent like Nicole. So here's, I guess, what we're learning today is that, you know, putting your home on the market is the first step. Now, what do you think about let's go back to the three-legged stool. So if I am doing a contingent deal myself, do I want to make an offer on a property where they're doing the same thing? In other words, do I want to become the buyer similar to the buyer on my property, on someone else's property, where they, you know, it's like this daisy chain could go on forever, right? So
I've seen it up to five. I've seen it up to five properties at the same time. Talk about the level of stress. It worked.
See, and that's incredible to me, because that's so many variables involved there. Should I not be concerned about that on the buy side?
If you are working with a good agent and your agent tells you that they're going to have an open line of communication with that listing agent, and that listing agent is competent and has done that type of transaction before, then you should not be afraid.
Okay.
To get into a situation like that. It can be done. Mm-hmm. I've seen it happen.
Yeah. So it can be done, but maybe be conscious of it.
Mm-hmm.
Of what's going on.
And the level of stress can be higher because now you have a seller on that end. They're not just selling an investment property that they're liquidating and they already are in another property. You're dealing with a seller that's also going to have a high level of stress because they're trying to get into their replacement property. They're going through inspections on their deal, but know going into it that they might need to buy some time, which means you might need to also buy some time with your buyer. So if you've got that sellable property and you're having a lot of interest and your agent is going to continue to do backup showings while you've got that tied up with a buyer, then it will work out.
Okay, so be very open with communication, all parties.
Yes.
Stay involved. Don't just assume that everything's going to work out perfectly. There may be a hitch here and there, but as long as everyone's on the same page about making it work, it should be okay. Right. Anything particular that you think, because there are also people who are moving down too.
Yeah,
that's
absolutely
happening. Although this is what we would call a move-up market because equity's up. Some people are empty nested or whatever it may be, or they're finally cashing out on that home they've had for 30 years and whatever,
we'll call it, you know. Right-sizing.
Right-sizing, yeah. Right-size it up. Any tricks of the trade people should know about? Either direction, really, in just a market that's like this, low inventory, high demand.
You know, just having your ducks in a row. So whether you're buying up or you're moving down and downsizing, having your loan pre-approved, and there's lenders that will issue a full approval on your loan subject to the property, so that will give you the purchasing power. Having your other property listed for sale, having the purchasing power to show on your contingency of the property sale agreement that you're checking the box, yes, my property is in escrow, this is the MLS number, my agent is sending them the MLS listing and a copy of our listing agreement, and we're also writing a cover letter that says, hey, once we have a new property in escrow, we are going to be completely 100% motivated and flexible to sell our property. So we're going to start to get aggressive.
Are there any deals left in this marketplace?
Deals? I think there are deals. It just depends on the neighborhood that you're looking for. I still think you can negotiate a great price. The rates are still historically low, even though they bumped up, you know, slightly after elections. I think rates are going to continue to rise.
What about downtown?
Downtown.
Italy, that, you know, your whole hood.
Little Italy and East
yeah,
Village.
Any deals still down there?
Definitely deals to be had. Actually, there's been a level, a higher increase in inventory in the under 400,000 price point.
Really?
So I've been seeing quite a few lofts, studios, and one bedrooms list in VA approved buildings, which is great. So, you know, you can have an FHA-approved building or a VA-approved building or a conventional. But conventional, you can finance 3.5% to 5% down, VA 100%, FHA 3.5%.
You're telling me there's more inventory, so there's more to choose from in those.
There's areas. More to choose from.
Wow.
Yep.
Okay, that's a huge tip right there, especially for the VA buyers who want to live the downtown lifestyle. It's also really close to Coronado, which is nice, you know, for them because it's a really short trip. I mean, a lot of these guys live, you know, really far out. Neighborhoods and stuff like that. So
well, yeah, and the new UCSD College extension for their campus is coming downtown, and the Ritz-Carlton is in the process of being built, and all of the development in the East Village. So if you're buying on the outskirts of East Village at places like Metrome and Smart Corner and Icon, that will eventually be the central East Village location.
Totally agree. Great stuff. Nicole Hazelton, thank you so much for being here.
Thank
really
you.
Appreciate your time.
Thanks.
Stick around for more Smarter San Diego TV, where we guarantee to make you smarter than everyone else, commercial free.
How did our recent rain spell affect your home? The owner of the real estate inspection company is here to the rescue. Please welcome Philippe Heller.
He's back.
Love to be here.
Philippe Heller is here. What's up, my man?
It's been a busy month with all the rain and real estate's picking up again. So busy.
So they told us that that the drought is over, but at the expense of a lot of people's roofs, including your own, right?
Including mine, yes. We learned the hard way that that it does rain in San Diego, and roofs are an important feature of a house.
It's not just to keep you shaded from the sun.
That's right.
They're actually to protect you from the elements, too.
That's true.
So what is it that, I mean, because I had so many people that I know who were writing on Facebook, or people I had appointments with, and they're like, sorry, leaky roof, I have to go deal with it. One guy just had his roof redone last year.
Oh, wow.
And he has major damage in his house. I mean, it's a major, major deal. So you guys inspect more homes in San Diego than anybody. When you're looking at these roofs, or when people are thinking about the roof, which they are probably now more so than they were before, what are the things they should be considering or looking at?
Well, first of all, houses are not waterproof. You know, there's no house that is a boat, you know. So given the right circumstances, any roof can leak. wind-driven rain. We don't get a lot of wind here. It's not like Florida. They have different styles of roofs that they put in. There's a lot more consideration about where the vents are with regards to the wind patterns and whatnot. But one of the things that determines the effectiveness of a roof can be the age of the house or the roof itself. There are different materials, obviously. There's asphalt shingles, there's tile roofs, there's flat roofs that we have here. And each one of those roofs has a lifespan. And if not properly maintained, when you get to, just like your car, you know, if you get to the end of that lifespan and we get a heavy rain like we just had, you're going to notice that water finds its way in.
So there's no one roof type that's better than the other, or no, you know, because you mentioned several different kinds there.
Well, there, it depends. It's all about cost and longevity. So you can have a slate roof like on a castle in Europe. You just came back from Europe, mm-hmm. probably saw a few castles.
Yeah.
Those roofs can last 100 years or more if they're installed properly and the slate never wears out. But they're very expensive today to put a slate roof on a house. You can do a very inexpensive home with asphalt shingle roofs that last 20 years. They're not hard to put in. You could have it done in a couple of days, but they're only going to last about 20 years. And in the sun, in some areas of San Diego, they won't even last that long.
Yeah.
But they're cheaper to put in.
They're very thin, too.
Yep.
I mean, it's not that difficult to puncture.
They can. We've actually found in some parts of San Diego, and I'm not going to name them, but where people shoot guns in the air on New Year's, we've actually found rounds piercing roofs, roof material.
Seriously?
Absolutely.
Oh, my goodness.
Yep.
That's scary.
A couple of times, yeah. But at least the roof stopped it.
Oh my, bulletproof roof.
Mm-hmm.
But still can't stop the rain.
Yes.
Because water's tough.
It is.
Water's tough in every place there's water, mm-hmm. when you guys are doing an inspection, that's always like the big consideration. Where's moisture?
Sure.
Where's water running? Is it getting out of where it's supposed to be?
Mm-hmm.
The roof is one thing that's really tough for you to test as an inspector. You can't just go up there and pour buckets of water on the roof.
That's right. We don't water test. It'd be great if we could have a fire truck come in and spray the house while we're there, but that's not realistic, so we have to look for evidence of leaks, of past leaks. That's the only way a home inspector, other than, you know, if we get on the roof or with our pole cameras, we can see broken or missing tiles or, you know, obvious defects in the roof. Obviously, we would call that out. But if a roof looks good from up top, then the next step is to go inside the home, look for physical staining or you know, some sort of feature inside the house that would indicate, or in the attic, that it had leaked in the past. And then we make the recommendation. That way.
I would think that probably the number one piece of advice would be like, hey, don't ignore a small leak, right?
Absolutely, because they never get better.
Yeah.
They always get worse. And, you know, if your house, even if you have a tile roof, which is very common in San Diego, your standard concrete tile roof, and your house was built in the mid-80s or even the early 90s, you are probably facing having to do the underlayment very soon. And that's where I'm at. My house is about 30 years old, and the paper underneath the tiles is just worn away because I live in Ramona and there's a lot of sun, and so the oil impregnated paper is just deteriorated now. And so there's no water repellency left in the paper.
Mm.
And all the tiles have to come up, new paper, and you know, redo the roof essentially.
Okay. And so that's something to not be really ignored here. I mean, at least one of the people that I talked to who had a roof issue during this last rain, mm-hmm. and this rain was pretty crazy. Like,
yes.
We don't normally see something like this. But man, if it gets to you, boy, does it get to you. So this guy, he ignored a warning sign.
Mm-hmm.
First rain first started, he had a little leak.
Mm-hmm.
And so he didn't do enough about it, let's put it that way. And then now he has a mess on his hands. I mean, they're having to pull out wall, you know, drywall,
oh, yeah.
and redo rooms. And I mean, it's just in the bedrooms too.
Yeah.
So it's never fun. Let's put it that way. It's never fun to have a leaky roof.
Mm-hmm.
And you normally don't have to worry about it. But what are some of the things, like, he just had a new roof installed the year before. So, I mean, does that even
matter?
Well,
that's an installation defect, and I'm not familiar with that. So I don't know. Somebody installed something incorrectly. And he needs to work with the roofer who did that. Now, when you have unusual high winds, sometimes there's nothing you can do about it. Water's just going to blow in through a vent or something, and sometimes you just can't avoid it. But a properly installed roof really shouldn't leak. Now, when we do home inspections, and the house is 20, 25 years or more, and it looks like the roof has never been replaced, we will notify the buyers because it's something they need to consider. It may not be leaking today, but within 5 years, they certainly are going to be faced with some repairs on the roof.
I wonder how many people who've had solar installed,
mm-hmm.
that's been a huge issue.
Mm-hmm.
Roofs and solar just seem to not be going well together.
I have that. I have solar panels.
Okay.
Which will, at least the panels will need to come up if the paper on that side of the roof needs to be replaced, which I'm going to do. And that is one problem with a lot of the solar companies, the way that's structured. That's, we could do a whole other show on that, which I would like to, because a lot of them have gone out of business. And the people going around the neighborhoods knocking on doors and doing the installations, people would ask, is my roof suitable for solar, or should I redo it before you put it? And they always said no, because they were so hungry to just get that solar array installed and signed off. They got their money, handed off the contract to somebody else, and they went out of business or sold or whatever. So they're immune to the leaks right now.
They were basically putting solar on bad roofs. Roofs that needed to be replaced.
Yep.
They're installing solar on those roofs.
Correct.
Putting more holes in the bad roof.
Mm-hmm. Correct. Instead of just saying, hey, at least let's repaper this section so that you don't have to deal with it, they just said, oh no, everything's fine, and they would put the solar panels on. And so now if we do have problems, the panels need, and it's not the end of the world, they just need to come off, but it's an extra expense that you're going to be faced with in doing your roof.
Yeah, and if that is the case, unfortunately, you probably had some issues with the recent rains. These were unrelenting downpours like I've never seen here.
Yes, parts of San Diego got up to 8.5 inches of rain in 4 or 5 days, which is almost what we get in an entire year. We get about 9 inches on average, and we got that in a few days. Flooded some houses, too.
Flooded some houses. Fixed the drought. I know down here, there's a low-lying area down by that little driving range that was just a complete mudslide.
Yes.
So there was some really interesting stuff that happened, but all those things, and it also, it's a good opportunity to really look and see if you have water accumulating in areas, right? When it does rain like this, up against the house or near the house, which can cause other bigger problems.
Yes, correct. Prior to the winter, people should go around their homes, look at the roof, get any leaves or debris that may have fallen and collected in any of the, you know, crevices of the roof, the valleys and whatnot, the rain gutters. If you don't have rain gutters, you should really look into getting them. They're not expensive. You can get nice seamless gutters put up. And what that does is it catches the rain and moves it away from the base of the house instead of having it just all the water that collects on your roof pouring down on the side. And it's extra important, especially if you have a crawl space. You want to keep the water out of the crawl space. So we highly recommend gutters, which are not required in San Diego. And like you said, make sure that the dirt around the home or the pavement or pavers or whatever are sloped away from the home so that water is directed away. And check your yard drains. Do all that before the rains hit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So those are things you can do now.
Yes.
Make sure that you don't have problems.
Well, now
later.
Might be a little late. You should have done that about 4 weeks ago. But yeah, before the winter, a couple times a year,
rewind.
You should get that. Also, if you have a roof that has a big, thick layer of leaves on it, the other effect that can have is it traps moisture in the roofing material, which can further degrade the roof. So roofs should shed water and dry out. And if you have a thick layer of leaves on there, that moisture stays in there and can rot your roofing material and the underlayment very quickly.
You know, one thing that's interesting here in San Diego that I've never seen anywhere else is all the flat roofs that we have.
Mm-hmm.
Those seem to be problematic in situations like this. I mean, it's very difficult to have a perfectly flat roof.
Well, they're not flat. They are always, or should at least, have a slope or some sort of crowning so that water is directed. Even on a huge retail store, a big box store, Home Depot or something, you know, they're giant flat roofs. But really, they are peaked and valleyed so that water is directed off of them. Otherwise, it would just become a huge lake and it would collapse. So it's all directed towards scuppers, which are the roof drains. And again, if you have trees nearby, you need to go up there or hire somebody to do so and get the leaves off of there, because if those get blocked, it will fill up and will absolutely find its way into your home.
Yeah. No question.
So flat roofs are fine, but they have them even in snow country, and sometimes they collapse when too much snow gets up there.
Yeah, well, we saw a lot of snow, too, that came with these rains.
Did.
Bear Mammoth got an insane amount of snow.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the pictures I saw online were just crazy.
Sure.
Anything else that people should know about roofs or preparing for the next potential downpour here in San Diego?
I would say, just like so many things, is walk around your house, use your judgment, clean your gutters, you know, just look at your home. And certainly if you have experience, we do get big rains periodically. So if you know that you've got some grading problems or drainage problems, we've had some friends who even bought sump pumps because their house is flooded numerous times. The water would come in on their patio and just couldn't get directed away. And so they added some pumps to assist in that. So, you know, just make sure your house is clear of debris and that the drainage is good. And you can even test some of that with a garden hose and just imagine instead of a garden hose that you have a fire hose during the rain and try and preempt any of those problems.
Fantastic stuff. Philippe Heller from the Real Estate Inspection Company. Yeah. Good to see you, my friend.
Always.
Stick around for more Smarter San Diego TV, where we guarantee to make you smarter than everyone else, commercial free.
Our next guests are here to talk about staging. Please welcome Realtor for Century 21, Steve Ploetz, and his guest, the owner of Showhomes San Diego, Lisa Gulliver.
And he's back. Mr. Ploetz, what's going on, my friend?
Not much. Another beautiful day here in San Diego. Nice to get done with the rain. Yeah.
And you brought Lisa Gulliver today.
I did. Lisa with Showhomes.
And you've probably seen their ads. If you've been looking for a place to rent on Craigslist, you've probably seen the home manager option going around there. We're going to talk about that today.
Great.
You guys also have a one-day makeover, which is an interesting thing that you guys do. But Steve, from a more macro perspective, tell us why you think that what they do in staging is so important.
Well, I guess there's a variety of different reasons that I would say it works. Number one is residential real estate is bought and sold on emotion, is that people make decisions based on how spaces make them feel. As much as we would all like to think that it's price per square foot and it's look at comps and it's appraisal issues, et cetera, most people that are purchasing a primary residence are thinking less about those items and more about, can I raise my family here? Can I have my mom live in this downstairs bedroom? Those kinds of things. And sometimes the spaces are very specific to us, as homeowners, versus a more general and allowing the spaces to be seen as they more properly should. And that's where the staging really comes in.
Okay.
I've seen it numerous times, and I have many examples where someone has tried to sell a house unstaged, and then we've come in and staged the property and been able to move it quickly and for a higher price. And it has nothing to do with, oh, that I'm such a great realtor. It has to do with the staging, in my opinion, that people see that and think, I can see myself here now, where before it's just a big empty house.
Gotcha.
Yeah, if I could jump in here, please. You know, Steve and I have done a lot of work together. I don't know if you know this, we've staged close to 50 homes together.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And, you know, what we're really doing is selling a lifestyle. You know, we want the buyer to walk in and see themselves live there and see the potential of the property. If the home isn't staged, it's hard for them to start thinking about where is my couch going and how am I, you know, how's everything going to fit. But we're basically portraying a lifestyle or portraying how great the property can look, what's its maximum potential, and how they're going to live there. And they can see themselves there. And typically, you're going to get a higher offer. It's going to sell faster because people get more excited about the property, and they do have that emotional connection to the property.
Yeah, and I've heard people say before that people buy real estate on emotion, but I think the way Steve described it was perfect. It's not just an emotion. It's about how the property makes you feel, you know, which is an emotion. But how does it make you feel? I think that's a better explanation, because if you walk in and it feels like home, or it feels like a place that you would want to live in, you're like, wow, can you imagine if we could live in this place?
Yeah, exactly.
That's going to get someone juiced up to write an offer. Yep. You know what I mean? That'll get them excited. And I think that's really, really important. So it's been proven many times, you can Google this if you want to, that, you know, staged homes sell for more. And, you know, in a lot of cases, dramatically more. But overall, they sell for more, and it's worth it. It's been proven. So we don't have to sit here and have a discussion about whether it's worth it or not. Like, the math's done. Yeah. But it's really a matter of, you know, how good of a job you're going to do in that situation. You guys have several things that you do that are really unique. So tell us about the one-day makeover. What is that?
Yeah, so the one-day home makeover is where in an owner-occupied property, people get used to seeing their stuff every day, right? And it's hard for them to get an outside perspective of what a buyer's going to see when they walk in the door. So we're there to help them with that perspective. So we'll go in and give them suggestions on how to declutter, how to depersonalize, how to, you know, move the furniture around to make the room look as big as possible and look as comfy as possible. And then they go away for the day. I bring my team in. We move all the furniture around. We rehang the artwork. We, you know, make every room look it's as good as possible. And then we bring in the lipstick. So we bring in art, accessories, plants, things to decorate the home and put that lipstick on the property so that it's going to be gorgeous. By the end of the day, the homeowner walks back into the property, it's a whole new home.
So and now they're like putting... Someone goes to work in the morning.
Yeah.
You guys are there all day. They came home at night. It's a totally different place.
Totally different place. Yeah. And we've had many homeowners walk in and say, oh my gosh, now I don't want to sell. Yeah, it's so great. Yeah.
Why didn't I do this? All right, I'm canceling the contract. I mean, they haven't actually said that. But but people walk in and they go, I should have done this when I moved in.
Yeah.
Versus when I moved out. Yeah, we see it all the time in people that make repairs and upgrades for the sale. And really, it's just having a professional that can see the spaces and can understand how things really functionally work. But as she talked about making spaces comfy, that's pivotal. Mm-hmm.
We also are consulting them on paint colors, you know, if they need new carpet or not, landscaping suggestions, things like that. So it's the whole package. We're going to give them the whole package to get that top dollar for
not
that
just
property.
The interior.
Right, not just the interior.
The whole shebang. Okay.
Exactly.
That's all in one day.
All in one day.
Incredible. Mm-hmm. I think that's really appealing, I think, because I would say the big issues with people are the time, you know, for the inconvenience of, oh, well, everything's got to be moved. When are we going to do this? When? And then the depersonalization, people have trouble with that sometimes emotionally, right? Because
it's tough.
You're telling them that, you know, pictures of your kids and your grandkids here on the wall are not necessarily appealing to someone else. I'm like, what? But it's reality, you know. Mm-hmm. People want to be able to see their own pictures of their own kids and grandkids on those walls, and you can't do that if your grandkids and kids are on the wall.
And I would say the third thing that people are very sensitive to is the cost. And so we have an arrangement where as the agent, I pay for it. So I go in and all of Lisa's time, all of her work, everything that she does is covered by me. So it not only is it so beneficial to the client based on the data that says that they're able to get more money and whatever it may be, but it doesn't cost them anything out of pocket.
Wow. Doesn't cost them a thing.
Great program.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
That's a no-brainer.
Yep.
An absolute no-brainer. I had no idea that I was looking at your ads, but for years, looking for rentals in San Diego, I saw the home manager posts on Craigslist.
Yeah.
I'm sure other people have seen them too. It's like this mansion, the price is super low. You think it's a scam. Like, you're like, this is a scam. There's no way that I could live in that mansion for $4,000 a month. But it's not a scam. You're the one who's been posting it. Tell us about this.
Well, Showhomes has been around for about 30 years. We've done home manager staging all 30 years, and it's newer to San Diego. We've been doing about 8 years here. What we're doing is looking for people who are super neat and tidy, super clean, and we're going to place them in a home that's for sale, that's vacant, that's staged. We beautifully stage it, and then we bring in basically human props. Mm-hmm. They're there to prepare the property for buyers. So it's basically going to be a showing on steroids. The showing is going to be so amazing because the home manager, before they leave the property, before the showing, is turning on the lights, turning on the music. They're having the home nice and warm and cozy on a cold day, or it's nice and cool and air conditioned on a hot day. And so when the buyer walks in, it's not only gorgeously staged, but all the lights are on, the music's on. It's this big production, and they're going to get more excited about the property. Plus, with a home manager living in the property, a buyer isn't walking in thinking, oh, okay, the house is vacant, so that owner is paying two mortgages. Let's see how desperate they are, right? So with a home manager living in the property, the closets are staged, the pantry is staged. It looks amazing. And they don't even go thinking that, you know, they don't start thinking about whether the owner's living there or not living there and whether they should lowball the offer. So you're going to get higher offers from that as well.
Very, very interesting. But the real cool thing is the home manager. If you're a tidy enough person, I'm sure you guys get a lot of applications.
Yeah.
This is a really cool deal. But you get to live in this luxury home for a fraction of the price.
The home manager.
Dramatically lower.
Yeah, exactly. The advantage to the home manager that's living in the property is they're paying 30 to 50% of what normal rent would go for that property. So they can save thousands of dollars a month and live in a beautiful home, live in a mansion. And that's kind of their job, right, is to keep the house clean. They professionally clean the home regularly. They're getting the cobwebs out of the corners. They're watching out for issues that might come up on the property to let the owner know the sprinkler's broken. Or last week we had two properties that had leaks in the rain. We had so much rain. And those home managers caught it right away. We got somebody out to the property to address those issues. So the home manager is just really there to help take care of the property, and the advantage to them is they can live in a gorgeous home that they could normally not afford.
Yeah, I mean, some of these homes, you know, should be, you know, $10,000-$12,000 a month in rent. They're $3,000-$5,000 mm-hmm. a month as the home manager. You do have a little responsibility, but you have a fully staged home. I mean, it's furnished, staged, beautiful luxury home. And when that house sells, I understand that they can, as a home manager, you can stay on. You can move from there to another one.
Yeah, they may say, hey, I want to try La Jolla now. Hey, I haven't been to Carlsbad before. Let me try a house in Carlsbad. So we move them around from property to property as the houses sell. It's fun.
That sounds so much fun.
Well, and
are you doing this, Steve?
You know, when I was single, we talked about it. Talked about potential, because especially as a realtor, I understand the whole world of prepping the house for sale and what needs to be done. And as a single man, I didn't have a lot of furniture, a lot of stuff to deal with. I will say, from the real estate side, what's wonderful about it is exactly as Lisa alluded to, is that if someone comes into a property and they see it's vacant, or even sometimes if it's staged and they recognize that this property is purely staged and that there's nobody living there, they think, well, I can come in more aggressive. Perhaps they've got property taxes, mortgage, HOA, whatever it may be. This seller is looking to get out. With the home manager, we completely eliminate that issue.
Yeah, and any advantage you can get in the negotiation process.
Yeah, and Steve, you would have been a great home manager. It's too bad you didn't do that. And we are very, very particular about who we choose for the home managers.
I would have made the cut.
Maybe. You would have. Yeah,
He's tidy.
You know, we've had a lot of executives who are transferring from out of state and need someplace temporarily as well. But yeah, we're looking for those folks that are going to be super flexible and super neat and tidy and take care of the home.
Well, it's a fantastic program. You're doing great stuff, Lisa. Thank you so
Thanks.
Much for coming on today.
Thank
really
you.
Appreciate it, Steve. Great idea
right.
bringing her on.
Thank you.
And of course, stick around for more Smarter San Diego TV, where we guarantee to make you smarter than everyone else, commercial free.
And now it's time for the Real Estate Debate, where we debate the hottest topics in San Diego real estate. Let's welcome today's guests. Guest number one, Benny Charles, broker for C2C Realty. Guest number two, Joseph Aronson, CEO of the Aronson Group. Guest number three, Sonia Azizi, team leader of Team Azizi at Whistle Realty. And guest number four, Danny Davis, broker owner, Danny Davis Real Estate.
All right, here we are. It's time for the Real Estate Debate, January 2017. We have four great guests joining us today on set, and two fantastic topics, one for sellers and one for buyers. Let's jump right into the action. Please tell us whether you agree or disagree. Sonia, we're going to be starting with you.
Yay!
Yes! Welcome!
That's exciting. Thank you.
Put you right on the hot seat. Topic number one is for sellers. The real estate market is showing signs that we may be near the top. It would be wise to sell now if you plan to do so in the next couple of years. Otherwise, you're taking a risk that the market might turn over and cost you some serious cash. Agree or disagree, and why?
Agree. I know right now it's a good time to sell because we have no inventory. Mm-hmm. It's really low. And we have a lot of buyers and not enough homes, of course. So what's happening right now is we're overbidding and removing contingencies. Just in case the appraisal doesn't come in, we want to be aggressive. So I've had properties where I'm putting $20,000, $30,000 above their asking. So it's a great time to sell, absolutely. And if you're planning on selling in 2 years anyway, why wait? We know right now this is the best time to sell because you're getting over asking. Mm-hmm. So we can't tell the future. You know, we don't have a crystal ball, but we do know what's going on right now, and we have no inventory, and we can sell your house at the right price. So why wait?
So what you're saying is basically bird in hand versus two in the bush. You know, right now is a good time, but I don't know what 2 years will look like.
I don't know what 2 years are going to look like, but I'd love to sell your house now and above asking. So absolutely, I have plenty of buyers.
That's true.
Yes.
Danny Davis.
Yes, sir.
What's up, man? What do you think? Agree? Disagree?
You know what? I agree. I agree somewhat. So we all know that the market is cyclical, right? We're at the upper end of the market right now. Is it still going to continue to go up? It may somewhat, but you can't get greedy in this market, right? Because people got greedy when the market bust in like 2006,
correct.
And they decided not to sell. They wanted it to go up a little bit more, and they didn't. And then I equate it to chasing a ball downhill. Once that bubble burst, the market started going down, and sellers started to have to reduce their price. What I'm seeing in my market right now is that you're getting a little bit more inventory, and the time on the market is is getting to be a little bit longer. So now buyers are having a little more options. To me, if you're thinking about selling, I would sell while it's hot, not get greedy, and just come up with a game plan for buying another property.
That's my biggest concern that you just brought up, is that sellers are being greedy. When we say greedy, meaning that they're waiting. They're saying, oh, well, I do want to sell, but I'm not selling because I want to make that money.
Right.
And I'm getting paid to wait, so right. I may as well just wait.
Right.
Which is an issue, because if everyone does that, then we sort of artificially drive up the market. And then when everyone says, oh, it stopped going up, let's all put our homes on the market, now we have a flood of inventory and that causes the prices to go down. So that's exactly what I'm concerned about, is that it's gone up so much in such a short period of time and has been so consistent with no ups and no downs, just
right,
all
no
ups,
downs, right.
that could be an issue.
But when you see a house on the market and you start to see a little bit more market time and you start seeing that with multiple homes, as a seller, you have to gauge your competition. You know, if there's no inventory, it's supply and demand. If there's no supply but there's a ton of demand, sell. If you're starting to see a little bit more supply than you do demand, then you know you've already missed that curve a little bit.
Gotcha. Joseph Aronson, what's up, man? What do you think?
How you doing?
Yeah, I disagree.
So I agree with everything that they just said. Hands down, if your only goal is to, you know, sell for top dollar, you know, take your money and run, kind of, you know, go for it. However, the situation that we're running into is I have some clients who, you know, they took advantage of the market back in 2006 and they sold at the peak and it was, you know, a staggering, you know, fall, and they were able to capitalize on that. However, we're not going to see that again. We're not going to see the market take that big fall. And, you know, right now, if, say, that client that I'm thinking of, if he were to sell, you know, he would have to go rent something, and rents are really high right now. And it's actually more expensive for him to go rent than what he's paying on his mortgage that he bought in 2010. So, you know, with that, I guess it's a case-by-case basis. Absolutely, if you're running off to a, you know, going back east somewhere more affordable, you can cash out and buy something cash,
yeah,
go for it. Or downsize into something and have a larger payment, go for it. But if your goal is to just capitalize on market, stick around in San Diego, and wait for the market to crash, I just don't see it happening.
Okay, I see. So what you're saying is, don't time the market thinking this is the top and you'll be able to buy cheaper next year or the year after that. But if you do plan to displace, if you're planning on going somewhere else, or if you're planning on getting into a rental because you know you will be eventually going somewhere else, then it makes sense to take the money and run.
It does. It does. It really does. And it's a case-by-case basis.
Do you feel like you're in the weeds a little bit?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Put you
in the
water.
At least the cameras are
over. Hey, man. It's like Jill's in the weeds. I feel like we're hunting here.
Hiding behind them over here.
Benny Charles.
Yes, sir.
What do you think about this particular topic, my friend? I know your area, for the most part, Escondido area. This is an area that's really exploded. Exploded over the past couple of years. How do you feel about this topic?
I agree with what they're saying. I consider it kind of like extra innings in baseball. Mm-hmm. How far does extra innings go?
That's a great analogy.
That's where 100% in extra innings right now. Market's at the top, keep on going. Someone can hit a grand slam and end it right there.
Yeah.
So my rule is, like, for my personal investments, I'd much rather sell 6 months early. I'm sorry, 1 year early, rather than 6 months too late. Mm-hmm. That's my golden rule.
Yeah. Well, you can't sell too early, right? You can only sell too
late. Yeah, you can only sell too late.
Like anything, where you're selling your business or, you know, anything like that. I mean, if you sell too early, you might be like, I missed out on a few bucks. If you sell too late, you might be like, I'm screwed. That's what I don't want to see happen. That's my main thing right now.
And the only way that you know that you've sold too late is on past data, right? So you're trying to gauge the market, and the market's cyclical. You know, sometimes it's little tremors, but if the market's going down, you know that because of past data, which means your house has gone down as well.
You're late. Yeah,
right.
No, you're late until it's too late.
Right.
I don't know. I don't think the market's going to go down the way it did before. I don't believe that. I think that maybe the interest rates went up a little bit just because we could stop it from going up too, because it was going up too fast. So the interest rates went up a little bit. I think it's just like we're going to just slow down. And again, everybody's freaking out about interest rates, but it's not that bad.
Right.
It's still at 4%, 4.5%. That's still okay. So to me, I think, I mean, if you want to just plan on selling, that's the topic. If you just want to sell, I mean, do it now and get more for your house. But I don't think that it's going to go down drastically in the next 2 years. I think
we didn't think that would happen last time.
But
either.
I mean, last time you saw what happened. You got a bunch of unqualified people buying homes. you know, at 6.5 interest only, negative ARMs. It's different now. These are all qualified people. I mean, yes, it's 3.5% down. We're looking at their pay stubs. We're looking at their W-2s. It's not the way it was where you just sign something and pretend, you know, you can qualify for something and you couldn't, especially with those negative ARMs.
Yeah.
So I think it's a little bit different now. I don't think it's going to go down that crazy amount, but I think it's always going to be great to buy. What's your alternative?
You're going to rent?
You know?
That's the big thing that's helping this market right now. If it weren't for that, rents being so high.
Yeah.
Because we didn't have that last time. Yep. Last time you couldn't rent your house, you couldn't give it away.
Right.
But now we don't have that issue anymore.
Actually, I saw that stat. In 2006, our average rent was about $1,400 for your two-bedroom, two-bath, you know, grade A home.
Yeah.
Or a townhome. Up to like $1,800, $1,900 for that same. So you can't just turn around and go rent a place and
say $2,500.
Yeah, $2,500.
That's the base.
Yeah, I don't know where that $1,800 deal is. Yeah.
How about your boy?
It's completely different than where it was.
And
I know
San Diego,
your rent
guys.
Isn't $1,800. No, no. My rent's not $1,800.
No, you live.
Anybody else have rent that's $1,800?
But what we're getting into though too is, well, we're talking about, yeah, it's a good time to sell. But when those buyers sell, they're not going to go rent because that's not smart. So they're going to have to go buy something. And are they buying at the peak of the market too? Mm-hmm. And what's the repercussion for that?
There isn't.
That's what
I mean,
I'm
you
running
can,
into a lot.
No matter what, I mean, yes, you're going to get some money out of here. But if you want to move up, that's okay. You take your money and take it somewhere else. Mm-hmm. I mean, what are you going to do even if the market goes down?
I agree with you, but with the
then
lack
your house goes down, and then the other property is down.
But with
down,
the
so
lack of inventory,
lose.
They're having a hard time finding a replacement property. That's
it just depends, like, yeah, that's true, but it just depends. If they're moving up, I'm like, the average price right now is like, what, like 600? Mm-hmm. FHA, VA, everything's up to 612, 950. So, they're moving up, obviously.
Right.
So, if they're moving up, I think it's a little bit better. I mean, what I'm seeing, depending on where you go, if you're looking at $800,000 houses versus, you know, the median price, which is, you know, with 600.
Right.
So if they're moving up, I think it's okay because it's a little bit more inventory and it's just not that much competition because you guys know, and I know, anything under 600,000 is just like 10
offers.
It's crazy.
Off the shelves, yeah.
So it just depends. Every situation's a little bit different.
Right.
Yeah. Good question. So you're very, very passionate.
Boy, yeah. Oh, sorry.
She's screaming at you.
Am I screaming?
All of us.
I have a lot of boys here, so I gotta make a point
here. She's representing women in real estate.
Right.
We'll tell you that. It's like there's
still
the
power.
Over here.
If you're a buyer and you're approved to $800,000, you don't have to spend $800,000.
Right.
You can find a nice house for $650.
Right.
And even the market crashes a little bit, it's still, depending on how much money you put down, it's still affordable payment.
Yeah.
So,
if you're buying in this market, it's okay. Just make sure everything's very affordable and comfortable.
Well, you
see, on a case-by-case basis, because if you're planning on buying a property and living there for 2 years, then it's a little bit more risky. But if you're going to live there for 10, 20 years, who cares what the market is doing?
Exactly.
You know, and again, you're right. Buyers are not investors, guys.
Right.
These guys are buying for their future.
Right.
So.
And it kind of touches base on what I was talking about. I mean, if you're looking at an investor standpoint, which you said, of course you want to time the market and try to sell at the top.
Yeah.
But as an individual purchasing your primary residence, I mean, find a place you feel comfortable with. As long as it's going to be a long-term hold for you, I mean, you're going to see appreciation over time.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. If you have a 10-year time horizon, you have to worry about the market at all.
Exactly.
All right. Jumping into topic number two, speaking of buyers. Buyers are in a really tough spot now with rates having gone up and pricing as high as they've ever been. And prices, I should say, not pricing. Prices as high as they've ever been. What's the good news for buyers in this market? I'm going the other side, Benny.
Oh. What's the good news?
Good news for buyers.
Okay.
Can we take it? Rates are so low. Even though they say rates are high, rates are so low. 30-year low. Okay, you get a home, you get a Ford. You're there, you stay there, you're gonna be okay. You're competing with a lot of people. That's not the best, that's not good news. But that's pretty much it, you know, that's what I would say.
Rates are still low, which is a great point. However, people have to understand, it's real estate does run in cycles, and if you look back in 1980 and 1990 when we had those peaks, and then even in 2000, you know, we saw very consistent growth, you know, 15-20% growth peak over peak. And then we had what happened from 2000 to 2005, which was, you know, we got to that that peak of 2000, and then all of a sudden here come the subprime loans, and it just blew the market, you know, into craziness. And so that set a new high for us. Now, if you continue and know that we're not going to see something like that happen again, you're going to know that as long as you're holding on to that property for 10, 15 years, and that is your primary residence, you're going to see equity built over time. Plus, you get the tax benefits, the inflation kind of insurance there, and there's just a lot of benefits there.
Okay.
So as long as you plan on staying there, buy smart, put yourself into a mortgage payment that makes sense for you, I mean, it's a great time to buy.
So does it make sense? And that's the key word right there.
Yeah.
It makes sense.
Yeah, and what you're saying, I think, is that the big bubble has already been burst. We've already that damage has sort of already been done.
Mm-hmm. Yep. That's still in the back of everybody's mind.
It is. But it would seem as though that would not be possible based on things that have taken place since then. The way the loans have changed, Financial Protection Bureau, things like that, that have come in and reworked it so that that shouldn't ever happen again.
Well, we actually have lending guidelines now.
Yeah.
Where before, yeah. I mean, it was underwriting. Like, sign here, sign here, how much do you want?
Yeah.
We have underwriting.
Yeah, exactly.
Danny, any other good news for buyers in the market?
You know, the rates, obviously, like we've stated, but I'm starting to see a little bit more market time. So if you have the capability to be picky, if there's a house that comes on the market and it's a hot property and they've got 10 offers on it, that may not be the house for you. So if you've got the patience, if you've got the time to sit out and wait to find a house that maybe sits on the market for 30 to 60 days, and then you write an offer on it and it's the one you like, and you can kind of, you're starting to be able to negotiate with the seller a little bit more now. Mm. Whereas before, you couldn't. It was like, here's a full price offer and please accept us. I know we're 10% down and you got a 20% down offer, it's like, here's a letter, here's our picture of us with our family, we want to call your house our home type thing. Anything that you can do to get your buyer that property, you would do. But with the market time occurring a little bit more now, the buyers are having a little bit more of an option if they have the patience to wait.
Yeah, patience. Okay.
That's what it comes down to.
Okay.
I mean,
it's good news for buyers.
I mean, I think it's great news for buyers. They can hire me as their agent. I'm kidding. But, yes, Benny's right. Everybody's right. Interest rates are still okay. But if you wait too long, what if interest rates go up a little bit higher, and it's just, it depends, like if you're in that 600 range, that could hurt them a little bit. Even if it's a half a point, which is still not a lot, then they can't afford that $600,000 house because they could, take their payments by $200. Mm-hmm. But right now it's still a good time. There's still properties on the market. I think it's just January. A lot of people, haven't listed their house or they're waiting. I think there's going to be things coming up, because we had a lot of expireds, last year that's not relisting. So, I mean, I think things are going to come up. I mean, we've had a few hundred, properties that listed, in the last couple of weeks. So there's a chance that you could still get into something. Don't freak out, but absolutely buy something right now because it's always going to be a good investment. Again, what's your alternative?
Yeah.
You're going to pay $3,000-$4,000 in rent or lock in your investment for the next 30 years and be those guys that are renting the house to you, have somebody pay off your investment.
Right.
So I think it's great time, any time to buy, especially if you're a buyer, not an investor.
So I have two things I want to add to this conversation, things that are good for buyers. First of all, interest rates are always in favor of the buyer, always. Because if you lock in today, let's say it's 4.5%, and mm-hmm. rates go down, then you can refinance into the lower rate.
Exactly.
If rates go up, then congratulations, you just locked in a rate that no one can get anymore.
Right.
So it's always, rates are fine. The other thing, and probably the most important thing right now, I think, for buyers to understand is that the rent versus own calculators have really started, tipping strongly in the buy favor.
Yep.
When you look back even just 5 years ago when prices were down, you still didn't quite have that. But because rents have accelerated more quickly than prices and rates are still really low, the rent versus own calculations is way favoring, the owns a lot more so than it ever has, than I've ever seen. I mean, there are a lot of people right now who can actually buy a home and get into it, even with prices being up where they are, for less than what they're paying rent.
Right.
And that never happened in San Diego in the past. And you used to have to factor in tax advantages and all these things to get the rent versus own to look right.
But you still can to make it look even better. I mean, renting, you're kind of throwing your money away and you're not getting any write-off.
What's the average rent? $3,000, say, for
a single family?
Yeah, for a single family home, $3,000.
Even if it's a townhome.
A year's time, $36,000, 4 years. I mean, come on, guys. That's a lot of money.
I mean, worst case scenario.
Plus, you don't get the write-off.
Hands down.
Yeah, not just write-off.
The interest rate on a rental is 100%.
It's what? 100%? What is 100%?
The interest rate on a rental.
That's a good
100%.
Yeah, and again, if something happens and you guys have to move out, and get into something bigger, rent it out.
Yep.
You know,
yep,
it's 3.5%. Buy another property, save up 3.5% in the next 5-7 years.
We only have so much land in San Diego.
Yeah.
So buy, hold, buy your next one, hold it, rent
yeah.
it out.
Rent
just
it
keep
out.
Buying properties.
Absolutely.
We're always going to see increase in values over time. So
see, lots of good news for buyers.
Lots of good news.
Guys, I would say great news for sellers right now.
Absolutely.
Great news. This is your opportunity if you're a seller.
Don't
right
wait.
Now. 100%. This is your chance. This is what you've been waiting for. You've been waiting for this moment right now where you can just go, you are all my you know what, and then you can dictate terms, and people are getting so much money. Some of these houses are selling for prices I'm just like, oh my gosh. But that's the kind of demand that's out there. So sellers, it is your time. Buyers, maybe a little patience will help you out, but you always win the interest rate game the way refinancing works. And if rates do go way up, then you'll really wish that you would have already purchased. So, guys, thank you all so much for being here today.
Thank you for
having us. Fantastic real estate debate with an awesome crew. And, of course, we'll be back again. Actually, we're going to do it earlier next month, the real estate debate. So check out the Facebook page for details, and we will see you then.
It's all about problem solving in a creative way. Taking a problem and stepping back and looking at it from different perspectives and figuring out some kind of creative way to accomplish something. And you know, I think that's the only way to ever do anything that's original that hasn't been done before. And I think all artists, that's the ultimate goal. You know, you want to be good and aesthetically pleasing, but more than anything, you want to be original. I think there are a lot of similarities between the way I approach art and surfing. You know, when you're surfing, you're looking for the right wave and reading the surface of the ocean and kind of paying attention to all these little elements that somebody else, you know, might not notice. Looking at a piece of wood is similar to looking at the ocean and trying to figure out where that wave should pop up.
And it is on.
Jamie O'Brien kicking for the bomb, looking for a 10.
Wow, this is going to be a good wave right here if we can come out of this one.
Come out.
Oh.
Of course it comes out.